Do you know how to use an elevator? Maybe you've heard about the three basic principles of elevator usage, but do you understand them? And more importantly, do you know how to put them in practice? Okay, let's start with the first one. This is the wedge principle. The width of the periodontium is very narrow, between 0.15 and 0.25 of a millimeter. In the area where the tip of the elevator is wedged, the periodontal space widens and the periodontal fibers are torn. Next is the principle of class 1 lever. A lever is composed of a fulcrum, long arm and short effector arm. Small force applied to the long arm can generate significantly larger force at the effector arm. We can apply this principle to the extraction of teeth. The fulcrum is the bone, the short arm is the part of the elevator in the periodontium, and the long arm is made of the shank and the handle. By moving the handle with the tip of the elevator, we can luxate the tooth. Next is the principle of the wheel and axle. Key players in this principle are the edges of the blade with the straight elevator and the tip with the curved ones. When you are inserting the elevator, its long axis should be close to parallel to the long axis of the tooth. The concave part of the blade rests against the root surface and the convex part lies against the wall of the alveolus. By moving the elevator in an oblique position relative to the long axis of the tooth, the blade of the elevator is placed in such position to the root surface. By rotating the elevator around its long axis, we can luxate the tooth. When using curved elevators, the principle is the same. Okay, so the three principles are... Well done! Before I explain how to apply these three principles in practice, you need to understand a few fundamental ideas about the elevator usage. First of all, the direction of the elevator placement. The idea is that the tip of the elevator should slide along the root surface so that it can get right into the periodontal space. If you ask me what is the exact direction, I would say that the elevator should point toward the apex of the tooth. If the direction is not correct, the tip of the elevator goes on top of the crestal bone. If you start making rotational movements, instead of going in depth of the periodontium, the tip starts scraping the crestal bone. I have observed students who were aggressive enough with this incorrect technique. They were able to dig through the crestal bone and get into the cancellous bone. This creates a situation of a wide bony pit next to the tooth which cannot serve as a fulcrum. Now, as you know what the direction of the elevator should be, let's figure out where exactly around the tooth you should place it. The idea is that a stable crestal bone is needed to serve as fulcrum for the elevator. That's why I always tell my students never to approach the tooth exactly vestibularly or orally, because the bone there in most cases is thin and can be fractured easily. Of course, there are exceptions such as the posterior region of the mandible. Vestibularly to the teeth in this area is the external oblique line. You know well that this structure is made of thick cortical bone and we can use it for a fulcrum. If the adjacent teeth are present, the elevator should be placed in the linear angles of the tooth, or medio-vestibularly, medio-orally, distovestibularly, distoorally. If the adjacent teeth are missing, the elevator can be placed directly medial or distal to the tooth. Never forget that the elevator is a cold weapon. Luxation of the tooth with a straight elevator should be performed with caution and control, as excessive forces can potentially harm and displace neighboring teeth. So active hand should control the instrument and the opposite hand should support the alveolar process and protect the surrounding tissues if the elevator slips. Before we start, let's clear out how the elevator should be held. The handle should rest in your palm. Through it, force can be applied when needed. The tip of your index finger should be as close as possible to the blade. The closer it is, better control you will have. Now, how to combine the three principles? Always start with the wedge principle. It most often serves us to place the elevator in the correct position. The most frequently observed mistake is the excessively large amplitude of rotation of the elevator while inserting it in depth. Since the periodontium is very narrow, The large amplitude does not allow the elevator to penetrate in depth and leads to scraping of the crestal bone. Because of this, rotational movements must be done with minimal amplitude. I'd rather say they are vibrational movements than rotational. How do you know that the elevator has entered the periodontal space? You should feel that the elevator slowly goes in depth and at the same time it starts to get stuck. Only then you can apply greater apical pressure. Continuing to perform the vibrational movements. If you do everything correct, you should feel how the elevator travels little by little in depth of the periodontium. Now, you're going to ask me how deep the tip should go. I can't tell you exactly how many millimeters the elevator has to go in because this does not matter. The idea is that the elevator is wedged between the tooth and a stable bone. Or simply put, the elevator must get stuck between the bone and the tooth. How do you know if you're deep enough to luxate the tooth? As you're wedging the elevator in depth, you can occasionally do a motion with bigger amplitude. The moment you're doing this, observe the tooth. If it doesn't move from its position, it means you're too superficial and you're just compressing the crestal bone with the tip of the elevator. This means you have to position it more apically. On the other hand, if you see that the tooth is moving, then you're close to the correct position. Short roots can be extracted only with the wedge principle. With longer roots, it mainly serves to place the elevator in the correct position and depth. True luxation is done with the second or third principle. Neighboring tooth should not be used as fulcrum because it can be luxated or fractured. Practically, the second principle looks like this. And the third principle is the following. Depending on the direction of the rotation, we can push the tooth in distal, medial, or occlusal direction. These principles can be used separately or combined in one continuous movement. You have to keep in mind that sometimes it's not easy to position the tip of the elevator in the periodontal space. Search for a different position around the tooth to get a feel for where the periodontium will allow you to go in depth. If the tooth is stubborn, change position, approach from several places. This way, you will be able to luxate it in different directions and accordingly to expand the alveolus in different directions. The fact is that in most cases, if you find a position in which the elevator can go deep enough, that is also the position from which you will extract the tooth. Quick tip, if you're extracting multi-rooted teeth with separated roots, luxate one of the roots and when it's already luxated, don't extract it, but use it as fulcrum for the other roots to be luxated and then extract them both. The elevator is great for luxation, but when it comes to the removal of the already luxated tooth from the alveola, or the so-called traction, elevator is not so useful and forceps is great for this. Another important thing is not to expect the tooth to come out in 5 seconds. It is normal, in the beginning, to be clumsy, not to succeed, and to need help from an assistant or a colleague. Okay, let's recap. What are the principles of elevator usage? What is the risk if you use adjacent tooth as fulcrum? What happens if you don't use small amplitude of the rotational movements while inserting the elevator in depth? Why you should never approach straight vestibularly or orally, and what is the correct positioning of the elevator around the tooth. This video provides a concise summary of the knowledge on this topic derived from the referred sources transformed through my clinical experience. If you find it valuable, hit the like button, subscribe and drop your questions in the comments below. You can join our mission by contributing on Patreon. Only together we can revolutionize dental education.